Hey guys, thanks for joining me on today's episode of Faith, Hope, Love, where we grow together in our faith, increase in hope, and learn how to better love God and love other people. On today's episode, we are in our What's Your Type Enneagram series, and today we are joined by a Type 2, Hunter Mobley, and he is the author of 40 Days on Being a 2. So Hunter, thanks for joining me on today's episode. If you wouldn't mind introducing yourself and answering our obvious question, what's your type?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, great to join you, Melissa, and I'm so glad to be a part of this podcast. I am an Enneagram 2, as you mentioned, and I'm Hunter Mobley. I'm based in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm an Enneagram teacher, so I get the privilege of traveling around when it's not in COVID lockdown mode and meeting people at churches and college campuses and other venues to talk about this great spiritual wisdom tool. So excited to be talking with you about it today. And it was, of course, a great privilege to be able to write, as you mentioned, 40 Days on Being a 2 in the last year and see that come to life and get to meet all the other great authors. It's a really fun and winsome series.
I've loved the Enneagram. It's helped me to really understand myself so much better, my marriage, my friends. And so I would love to hear kind of your perspective. How long have you been a student of the Enneagram? And did you know always that you were a type two, or were you maybe mistyped? What was your experience?
So my experience with the Enneagram began through meeting Suzanne Stabile, who's the series editor on this book. And we did not meet in an Enneagram context. We met over dinner. We were seated next to each other at a dinner party. And just in the course of, you know, what do you do and where do you live and who are you sorts of conversations, I discovered that she teaches the Enneagram. I'd never heard that word. And we began a friendship. And that friendship led to me discovering what this tool was that she traveled the country to teach. And so it's kind of perfect for me as a two to have discovered the Enneagram through the context of a relationship, because twos are all about relationships. So that was the beginning for me. And that was 7 or so years ago. And then not too long after I met Suzanne and I discovered my number through kind of sneaking in the back, she was actually coming to my hometown of Nashville a month or so later after we met. And she said, well, you need to come when I'm in Nashville, let's meet up. And why don't you sneak in the back of this workshop I'm teaching at a church, where she was kind of leading their church staff through her signature Know Your Number seminar. And so, of course, I wasn't on staff at that church, but I just kind of snuck in the back and they let me be there. And I listened to all the 9 types discussed. And, you know, Melissa, it's, as you mentioned, people have a different journey, you know, depending on just their life experience and their Enneagram number and just discovering what type fits them best. And some people, it's years of just kind of maybe sort of mulling over a couple different types. Some people, it's very quick. For me, it was pretty quick. There were a couple other types that I saw myself in, and they're types that are commonly sometimes mistaken with twos. But very quickly, at the end of that 8-hour day, I was pretty certain that I was an Enneagram 2. And then, of course, did work through the months and weeks and years to sort of confirm that, and which all culminated in the great opportunity to be able to really apprentice with Suzanne. And so now I get to teach from her ministry center in Dallas, and we do work together. And that's been one of the great joys of my life.
You know, I was able to kind of interview with Suzanne, and to be able to meet a female too, I know can look very different from a male too. And I know for me, just as a woman, most of my friends are women, and I have a lot of female friends that are too. I mistyped as a 2. And so I'm excited to just get to chat with you today to kind of see a male perspective, and hopefully for my male listeners that are out there, or maybe one of my women that's maybe married to a male too, just to get that perspective is so refreshing.
Well, and if I could say a word about that, you know, that's a really important, I think, topic with the Enneagram is there are certain numbers that culture has just not always set a great place at the table for, to be a particular gender in that number. And, you know, we sometimes first recognize it with female eights. You know, and we talk about how really the world just has not always set a great place at the table for female eights to bring all the gifts and the graces that they have to bring. We've kind of sometimes said, ooh, that's a little too much, or we need a little bit less of that. Could you just be sweeter? But it's interesting on the other side, male twos and male fours can be in a similar spot at moments where we kind of expect relationality and connection and empathy and tenderness from females, sometimes more than we expect it from males. And so it's interesting. I notice that as I travel and teach that male twos and male fours often cover with a big three wing. And I would imagine, Melissa, you as a female three, which is also, you know, what we might describe as an aggressive stance number, you know, an independent thinker and a mover and a shaker with goals and, you know, headed toward those. I think probably a lot of female threes also feel like sometimes they've got to really pick up that big two wing just so that they're sort of received in a way that then their gift can be delivered. And so it is interesting to just notice the different ways that gender roles show up. And of course, that's just one layer, race and ethnicity and life experience and the street you grew up on, all those influence whether or not we feel comfortable sometimes really living out of our number. And that's one of my great goals as I teach is to really encourage people just through knowledge of all the numbers to set a better place at the table for people to be who they really are.
Absolutely. And with this whole series, I'm really hoping that people don't just watch their own number, but also all the other types, because we know everyone in the different types. Maybe we just don't realize it. But I think it's so powerful to take the time to understand other people and the way others are wired. So obviously with you being a two, I would love for you to really speak primarily on that life experience. How have you seen your two-ness, I guess, come out with both your strengths and weaknesses and maybe also your kind of directions with stress and growth, both pre and post-COVID? I know that that can kind of affect the way that we kind of live into our personality as well.
Yeah. Gosh, COVID has really affected so much, hasn't it? And I certainly have learned a lot more about my personality. I'm sure everybody has. So, you know, for me as a two, I really feel like, you know, the best part of me is the worst part and the worst part is the best part. You know, it's strength wise, I really do value relationships, which means that I want to be a good friend. I want to be a good companion on the journey. I am interested in other people. I want to listen to people's stories. I would love to help someone who needs my help. So that all sounds great. But the challenge for me as a two is I can do all of those things in a way that is loving and freeing, or I can do all of those things in a way that's manipulative and controlling. So sometimes I find that when I'm not in as healthy of a space, that I am giving and giving and giving and extending and pushing down my own needs for the sake of other people. And then I get to the end of that and I'm tired. And then I recognize that the other person has not maybe thanked me or appreciated or noticed all that I've done. And then I start to martyr a little bit and see myself as a victim and see myself as somebody who always is helping and nobody makes room for my needs. And it just becomes this ugly kind of martyring thing. And people are thinking, you know, okay, get off the cross. We need the nails. So that's the both end of two-ness. You know, there. I think we have equal opportunity to give in freeing and loving and altruistic ways and to give in manipulative and controlling ways. And depending on the day of the week, I sometimes can choose both paths. And so that's, you know, I just noticed that in my own two-ness. And you mentioned stress and security. You know, as twos, we go to eight in stress and we go to fours in times of security. And, you know, one thing that I've noticed and that I am encouraging other people to notice is, you know, we sometimes think of, you know, stress and security as, you know, stress is when I'm doing bad and security is when I'm doing good and I'm on vacation, but not really. At the beginning of COVID, I think we were all in stress. You know, I mean, it was disorienting. Sometimes I think about the word, when we talk about our stress and security moves, sometimes I think more about the words disorientation and orientation. And, you know, so we make that move to our stress number when we're disoriented. And I saw that in myself. I saw myself in some healthy ways creating some good boundaries, which, you know, twos can only do if they draw from eight. In unhealthy ways, I saw myself sometimes experience a little bit more anger and resentment and frustration. But as COVID went on and we all kind of adjusted to the new version of normal, whether we liked it or not, whether it felt good or not, we all found our way to some kind of new normal. And once we find our way to a new normal, we're no longer disoriented. And then I think we start drawing from our security number more. And so what I found that I wasn't noticing, and I think sometimes other people haven't noticed as much, how quickly during COVID we moved to operating from the low side of our security number. And for me, going to four, the low side of my security number in four space really looks like me feeling very isolated, very unseen, very unheld, very unloved. You know, that's a lot of what the bottom of four looks like. And I can see myself there a lot of times. You know, when the martyring and the victiming gets so negative, that's a sure case that I've moved toward four, toward the bottom of four. Now, the top of four for me, I found some moments writing this book was a moment for me of, you know, a two can only write a book by accessing the high side of four, because otherwise it's too much time alone and we're verbal processors. And so it's too much time, you know, just with you and yourself and your own thoughts. And so you have to find yourself toward the high side of four to access some of those solitary creative moments. And at the very beginning of 2020, when I was putting this book together, I had to find my way toward that in some ways. So I'm a big believer that, you know, we can find ourselves in the high side or the low side of either that stress and security number. And we make those moves very quickly, very often, without often noticing that we're making them.
I think that's so powerful, just to understand that you can access the high and the low side of both your stress and growth lines as well. That's a thing that I've actually heard with a lot of different authors that I've been interviewing for this series, is that, you know, noticing that, like, if we're not careful, it's so easy to slip into the negative of both sides. I would say, like, maybe for your type, if you wouldn't mind kind of sharing about, you know, what have been in the last year, maybe some of the maybe tools or practices that you've kind of implemented to help yourself to stay more grounded and to grow in your health and wholeness as a two.
I think the growth edge for me, and probably a version of the growth edge for all twos, is time alone and becoming comfortable in spiritual practices and just mental and physical practices that are on your own, that are not connected to relationships, so that you can really think for yourself and feel for yourself. You don't have anybody else's feelings or thoughts to pick up as your own. And so for me, over the last year, you know, that's one of the gifts, of course, of times of, you know, like we've had in the last year where we just have done less, is that I have had more time on my own to do some creative work, to do some spiritual work. And so that's really a growth edge for twos, is sort of stopping yourself from always kind of needing to practice spirituality or practice creativity or just do life in the context of relationships. That's so important and that's needed and that's wonderful. But also the time of personal reflection where you don't have anybody else's thoughts or feelings to pick up as your own, where you really can do some hard creative thinking. I mean, that's so important for me. And another thing, Melissa, that I noticed that I need and I've had to work on in the last year is, you know, as twos, we are present-oriented people, which means that every future plan and goal that I have is subject to being disrupted by whatever is happening in the moment for me. And so I've really had to do some good goal setting in the last year. And that's a place where I fail constantly. That's a place where currently right now I'm noticing some big opportunities for growth and some big pitfalls of failure. Is there are some really important goals to me that I have been sitting on the back burner for a long time because there has been just so much to attend to, you know, tangibly and also just existentially in the past 18 months. And that's a challenge. And I have to notice the ways in which I am not getting to goals and not getting to the future in ways that I need to, because the current, just whatever the current fire of the moment is always disrupting that. And so that's just one of the growth edges for me personally, and I imagine for a lot of twos, because we are present oriented and we neglect the past and the future.
I think that's so important. Just, you know, obviously time orientation is a huge, huge part of the Enneagram. And maybe for someone that's watching this, that's never really studied the Enneagram before, I think that's something that's important to acknowledge, that obviously for twos being present, it's important to take time to address the past and look forward. And for me as a three, I'm very future oriented. So it's important for me to take time to look at the past and ground myself in the present. And I think for each type that's watching, you know, hopefully that's something that will encourage them, especially type twos, to understand that it's not just, you know, taking care of those fires, putting out those fires, but also, you know, addressing both the past and the future as well. So, you know, obviously the podcast being, you know, entitled Faith, Hope, and Love, that's kind of like the main focus for everything that we do here. So how has understanding yourself as a two helped you to kind of grow in your faith, increase in hope, and love God and love other people better?
Well, you know what is interesting? I love the title of your podcast, because that passage of scripture in 1 Corinthians 13 is sort of my favorite part. And so, and actually, it's interesting, Melissa, when I talk about and think about the Enneagram orientations to time, I kind of connect them in my mind towards faith and hope and love. And I think about faith as sort of being a good rootedness in the past, and love as being the present, and hope as being future. And so for me, a lot of the orientation to time work connects to faith, hope, and love. And I'll tell you, you know, love. I just want to make a comment about that, because Enneagram twos, you know, we love people, right? And that's kind of one of our gifts, is we really do. We love relationships. We love people. But one of the things that I notice that is a opportunity for me is that it's really, really easy to love everybody except for the people that don't love me. And I think that's a challenge for Enneagram twos, who privilege love so high that it's like we have all the love to give, but then we withhold love from people who we ultimately chase and realize we can't catch. And that's a growth edge, is figuring out what it looks like to even love those who curse us, you know, love our enemies in a biblical sort of context. So, you know, for me, I love your podcast title, because it reminds me of really the orientation to time work that's always an invitation. I mean, I got to work on future orientation and getting to my plans if I'm going to have any hope. And I've got to sort of learn a little bit better to integrate some more of the past into my life, if I can kind of cling to faith in what I've come to know and what I've come to trust and what I've come to believe. And then I think I get to the both and of recognizing that one of the gifts I have to give is the gift of love. And also that's a gift that can get me into trouble, because again, I can give that gift of love in a freeing and a loving way, or in a way that's manipulative and controlling. And that takes a daily inventory.
I think that's so powerful, and I appreciate you giving such positive affirmation. Again, as a three, I received that for the title of the podcast. And I feel like you've really laid that out so well, that our greatest strength for you as the two is love can be our greatest strength as well as our greatest weakness, and being able to take time to love the people around us, not just those that love us back, but those that that maybe are cursing us or are not very encouraging, right? Or receiving even of our love. So again, as having a two wing, I resonate with that a lot. So I really, again, I appreciate that you've taken the time to write your book. And I know for those that are listening that are twos, it is so, so important to take time to do that introspective work. So maybe for a two that's considering picking up your book, you know, how does your book really speak to the type two reader, and what can they expect to learn from you in that time?
Well, one of the things that I hope people will enjoy with the book is that, first of all, every day, you know, it's divided into 40 days, kind of, you know, an entry for a day. And so it's, if, you know, if people can actually take the 40 days to do it, you know, you can sit down and you can read it in a couple hours, and that's wonderful. But if you can take the 40 days, there's a prompt at the end of each day. And the prompt is just an invitation. Sometimes it's a prayer. Sometimes it's a question for just some personal reflection. Sometimes it's a practice to consider using that day. And so I think that, I hope that readers will enjoy that this book invites them into the story. This is not just my story. This is the story for all twos. And I've got my own little anecdotes about how twoness plays out in my life, but it invites the reader to consider the ways in which they resonate or don't resonate with some of my stories, but also prompts them to think about their own stories and their own lives and their own dreams and goals and needs and fears and challenges. And so it's, you know, one of the things that I love about the whole series, and I hope people will enjoy about mine as well, is it's an opportunity to hear each number described in the voice of that number. And that's unusual. You know, if you've ever read an Enneagram book or been to an Enneagram workshop or seminar, you have heard all nine types described by one number. And I do that too. You know, I teach and I'm guilty as charged, and that's, you know, wonderful and great, but there's something very special, I think, about hearing the voice of that number talk about the lived experience of that number. And so I really hope that readers, you know, this isn't designed to be an Enneagram teaching book. You know, it's really designed to be a lived experience kind of book and a journey. And so, I hope readers will enjoy that and will kind of approach it that way and, you know, recognize that there will be stuff that will sound like you and stuff that doesn't sound like you. And that's part of the gift of hearing other people's stories too, is realizing that even though we've got a similar Enneagram type, our lived experience is so different from one another. And there's ways in which we resonate and ways in which we don't. And that has its own interesting journey too. So I really hope, my goal was that the book would feel very winsome, very refreshing, very fun. Hopefully you'll get to kind of laugh at some of the ways in which I fall along the path. And maybe you'll see yourself in some of those and hopefully not see yourself in all of those places where I kind of stumble and find challenge. But yeah, it's a great journey to be on. It's a great series. I've read all of them because, again, I really, you know, I hope that maybe readers will take their certain type as the 40-day journey, but then you might read all of them just to hear that number described by that number. There's just something unique in that, I think.
I think for us, you know, if we're wanting to do like a transformation journey, I agree with what you're saying that it's intentionally 40 days because I feel like it's a daily process of transformation. And I agree with you. Like, I think there's so much value to, you know, taking a deep dive into other numbers, because I think if we maybe know someone that's, you know, maybe I know a four or I know an eight that, like, man, they just rub me the wrong way, it would help me to understand them better, understanding why they feel the way they do, why they act the way they do, and being able to see the gifts that they have to bring. And not just saying just eights and fours, but sometimes they get a bad rap, especially as women. And so I think it's so valuable, I think, for us to take time to really understand each number so that we can better empathize with them, love them, and just be able to be the best friends that we can be to each type. I would really kind of love, before we close up, if you wouldn't mind sharing maybe some final tips for the type two, as well as tips for those that love a type two.
Yeah. Oh, wow. That's it. I like that invitation. That's good. You know, tips for a type two. I think one of the things that we, you know, that we've talked about today is one of my most important things for me to remember, and I think for all of us as twos to remember, is there are goals and dreams that you are not getting to because every day there is a new set of fires. And you know what? Tomorrow there's going to be a new set of fires, and the day after that there's going to be a new set. And if you let all of those fires disrupt your dreams and goals, you will have a big set of regrets later in your life. And so I think that's something that twos always have to think about and always have to remember. And it's never going to be easy for twos. It's our lifetime of work is how do we privilege some of what we want to do so that that doesn't get lost in all the ways in which we are pushing down our own hopes and dreams and needs and feelings and elevating the hopes and dreams and needs and feelings of other people. And the other thing that I would say for people who love type twos is sometimes you have to ask the question twice or three times or four times. And what I mean is the first time you ask a two, what do you need? What are you feeling? What do you want? Where do you want to go? What do you want to do? What's your goal? What, you know, all that. Very likely the first time you ask that question, you are asking a question that is unexplored territory to the two. So if you feel like you're getting an evasive answer or the two is pushing you away or minimizing or kind of being deferential, that's not because the two doesn't want to be vulnerable. It's because you're asking the two something that they don't know the answer to. When somebody asks me, what are you feeling right now? A lot of times I kind of redirect. And again, it's not because I don't want to tell the truth or because I don't want to be vulnerable or because I think somehow I'm not safe with you. It's because I really haven't done the work today to figure that out. So if you really want me to give an honest answer to that, wow, I'm going to need to kind of process my way to that. And so I would just say for people who love twos, sometimes you have to give them the space, as frustrating as it can be, to do the processing to figure out their answer to the question that you're asking. This weekend, I was with somebody who asked me, you know, we'd gone to see something and they were asking me if I liked it. And they know me so well that they said, after they said, did you like it? They said, oh, okay, I know. I probably need to give you a minute to figure out if you liked it. And there is some of that, you know, in twos, because again, as a two, I can more easily tell you what you like or what you want or what you feel or what you need sometimes than I can tell you what I need or feel or want. And, so, you know, push back at us a little bit. When we defer, when we redirect, don't assume that that's because we don't want to be vulnerable or we don't want to share. Realize that it may be because you're just asking something that we have to take a little time to explore because we just have not done that yet. And if you can, you know, maybe invite us into that journey of exploring that. And ask us again, and maybe sometimes ask us again. And we'll get the point. At some point we'll say, okay, I see, I'm deferring or I'm redirecting, and let me process for a minute. Let me think for a minute and discover what it is that I want or what it is that's the answer to your question.
Man, that's calling me out because I'm now in my head listing out all my two friends that I'm like, man, I have not checked. I've asked what they're doing, but not how they're feeling. Man, I need to rethink that.
And we haven't the interesting thing is we haven't noticed that you didn't ask in a way, you know, because that's not really a question that we are that familiar with ourselves. You know, we're kind of push our own feelings down. So it's not like we're that offended if somebody doesn't ask us how we feel. I mean, we can get hurt if it seems like somebody doesn't really want us or love us or hold space for us. But yeah, that I love what you're describing. You know, it's like sometimes people don't think to ask how we're feeling, but also we don't think to notice that they haven't asked. And so we don't think to share.
I think, yeah, for all the rest of us types to be more cognizant, I guess, of if a relationship is reciprocal with a two, because even if they don't recognize it immediately, they may down the line recognize if it's not reciprocal. And that's obviously not valuable. And, you know, obviously all relationships that are healthy are reciprocal relationships. And I think especially with the twos, they love others so well and so often that maybe they don't ask for that themselves, and they need it just as much as any other type does. So before we wrap up though, you know, how can we continue following you, and you know, where can we purchase your book?
Thank you. Thanks so much. So I'm EnneagramHunter.com for my website, and also Enneagram Hunter is my Instagram and Facebook handle. So I would love for people to follow me there. You'll kind of see where I am and where I'll be next. And, you know, the book 40 Days on Being a Two is on Amazon, and you can find it there. It's also at IVPPress, you know, .com and all sorts of places. So really anywhere books are sold. And I got the great privilege. It was so fun of narrating the Audible version. So if you're an audiobook listener, you'll find it on Audible as well. But thanks for asking. You know, I would love for people to follow me and kind of see where I am. And I'd love to get to meet everybody listening as we start to get to travel again.
Well, thank you again, Hunter, for just taking the time just to chat with listeners about what it is to live as a type two, especially as a type two guy. That is a rare privilege. So I really appreciate your time. Thanks for joining me on the show.
Thank you, Melissa.
Well, everyone that's listening, thanks for joining me on today's episode of Faith, Hope, Love. I will see you back here next week.